bad.
And it hurts a lot.
It makes you cry.
It makes you unhappy. I find that I have to explain things to my children. They don't understand sometimes. But I think it's just part of what I have to go through with this work. Being in show business or being in this business as long as I have been, it is so wonderful. I really come from being in ecstasy. I mean, it's a wonderful life. And inside of all of this, there's all of these little things that sometimes make you unhappy. They don't always work, but it really is a wonderful life. I actually know that I don't know if there's any other business that I would have wanted to be in that would have made me as happy and give me such opportunity in my life. I really like what I do.
If I say Central Park to you, was that the highlight in your life?
Yes, it was.
Maybe you should explain what I'm thinking of.
I actually had I had a dream. I wanted to perform for the most amount of people at one time. I wanted to sing in front of the biggest audience I could sing to at one time. And to do that, I wanted to do it on television because it would be a lot of people at one time. I wanted to do a free show, a show that didn't cost to pay to get into. I was going to pay all the cost, and if we were going to sell t-shirts, banners, little trinkets, and from that money and my money added to that, I was going to build a children's playground in the city. And all of this was like a whole package I had designed. I was going to build a playground, do a free show, sing to the most amount of people in the world at one time. Never, ever. I had made this dream come true up to the moment. I mean, we had major meetings and people and everything. Never thought I was going to get caught in a rainstorm. Never. It's all right. We're going to get wet. That's okay. I'm here. Feels good, actually.
Is it true there were 600,000 people?
Yes. Yes, at the first day. People camped out early. They went into the park for picnics in the afternoon, and it was just an amazing, amazing evening, because one of the things I said on the stage is,
it took me a lifetime to get here. I'm not going anywhere. Stop raining! I'm not going anywhere.
And I really thought that the energy of all the people there, that maybe it was just a shower and it would stop. But the skies got black and it stormed. I don't think I'd ever been in such a rainstorm. On the film, you could see it was daylight when I walked on, and within 15 minutes, it was like black nighttime. And it was such an experience for me, because even though I was singing, I was praying, because I knew that if anyone had gotten hurt there, I get real emotional about this, that I would have felt responsible. It was the strangest thing, because I felt as if I could keep my eyes on everybody, that they would be protected. But if I left them, if I stopped looking at them, then something would happen. And so I didn't want to leave the stage. They almost had to pull me off the stage because I was soaking wet and I had an electrical microphone. And there was one cameraman who was a friend of mine, and he said to me with his hands, they had covered him up in plastic, as long as, he said, if you stay here, I'll stay. So that's why the camera was always on me. He was the only one camera that stayed. Everybody else cut off their lights. The band members left. There was one piano player playing Ain't No Mountain High Enough, and I was still singing and trying to get the people to leave the grounds without panicking, because I knew if I could talk to them, they would go out easier. And the next day when we went back to do a second performance, they gave us the chance to do that. And by doing a second performance, we had spent so much money. I mean, I was doing a free show, but I had to pay everybody else.
But did you invite them back?
They all came back. They came back the next day. And
how many came back?
Oh, at least 500,000. Yeah, at least 500,000 kids. See, kids somehow like the idea of the experience and the excitement of it all. I think this time around, I am gonna do it like you never knew it. Oh, I'll make it through. You look beautiful!
Thank you. There were many highlights in those years in your career.
I'm sorry I get so excited about that. I start to speak so loud.
It's very interesting. I was thinking about in those years there were many highlights in your career.
Yeah, there's been many in my entire life.
But you were a single mother. I mean, a single parent, I should say.
Yes.
And combining that with a career must have been a problem. Were you looking for another husband?
No, I wasn't looking for another husband.
No. Congratulations.
Arne Ness,
paragliding, climbing the Mount Everest. You know, how on earth does anybody get that into his mind to?
Well, for me, climbing was reasonably natural. I climbed a lot when I was a kid. My uncle, the professor, introduced me to climbing when I was 8 years old. And then I think that when I, at a later time in life, decided I want to do something before I got too old of a physical nature, climbing a mountain was the natural thing for me to...
And not any mountain.
Now, if you're first going to climb a big mountain, why not go for
why
the biggest?
Go for the... Another uncle who meant a lot for you in early years. That was Erling Dekke Ness, the shipping magnate, you may say.
Yeah, well, the two uncles, both of them have influenced me. First, it was Arne, who was a kind of a father for me. And you can also say that he was my moral mentor. And and then later, when I think in the early 20s, I started to work for my other uncle, Erling, the shipping.
So he taught you business? Owner.
Yes, he taught me what I know about shipping and his way of doing it.
And then you decided, now let's try something else. No, I've done some shipping, let me do something else. And that's when you decided on the Mount Everest.
Yes, which took 7 years to plan and... endless time to getting in shape for it and fit and all that. You know, that was a time and mind absorbing exercise.
How about the time and mind absorbing exercise you are doing now with being married to Diana Ross? Does that take much of your your time?
It takes a lot of my time.
Yes.
It takes it's but it gives a lot more pleasure than I think Everest. Everest was cold and hard work. No, but of course, yes, any marriage, and especially with two young sons, takes a lot of time.
Daddy.
My husband.
Yes.
You should hear our son call him Arna.
Oh, yeah?
Daddy, daddy. I wonder if I should sit on the other side of you.
No, my right side is my best.
Okay.
The two of you come from different milieus, and you are from different cultures, you even can say. What brings you together? Where are you alike? Where are you different? Why? Why? Why this?
Why you answer that?
I think you should tell him how we actually met, which is really before we knew very much. Oh, she obviously knew nothing about me, and I knew less than I should know about Diana, I think.
Yes.
But you know, to me, people don't you don't have to really come from the same country or the same state. There's a lot of sameness in, I think, where we do come from, which has to do with family and has to do with a lot of family unit. I think that's part of a lot of the sameness about us. I had been traveling on a tour and was taking the opportunity to spend time with my kids for a long weekend in Nassau. And we were there doing the rainy season again. It was rainy. And so the kids had been inside the little apartments, and they wanted to get out and swim. Even though it was raining, they figured they would be wet anyway. So they were swimming in the pool, and they met each other. Katinka, Christopher, Leona, Rhonda, Tracy, and Chutney were all swimming together.
Six.
And I never really let my kids swim alone, so I was sitting there watching them under this big red hat. And this man walks up, and he says, "Can I sit next to you?" And I didn't even look. I didn't look up. And I said, "Sure." And within a few seconds, I got up and walked away, and the children left and went out to the beach. And then I thought, I better go and check on them. So as I went to go to the beach to check on my children, Arne was walking back with all six of them. And so that evening, the children were getting dressed to go to dinner, and I was going to basically stay in the apartment. And sometime during that, I said, "You know, it's raining. Why don't you ask Mr. Ness if it's all right if I join you at dinner?" So they went to dinner, and I ended up going to join them for dinner. And I really didn't know that this was going to turn into something special. Until when I walked in, he was standing there waiting for me, of which I didn't expect. I was rushing over because I couldn't get my dress buttoned in the back. And I was unzipped all the way down to my waist. And he was standing there, so I said to him, "Could you ask my daughter, Tracy, to come in and button my dress?" And also when I walked in and saw him, he was standing there with a little bow tie, and I said, "Yeah, cute guy, you know, he's cute." And he said, "I'll button it for you." So I turned around and lifted my hair like this, and I realized, here's a stranger buttoning my dress, which is opened all the way down to the waistline here. And I was, and I started to feel funny, because, you know, he took forever to button the dress, because and I started to, you know, feel funny. And we went in to dinner. It was like that moment was our first kind of chemical attraction. Sometimes there is destiny. Do you believe in any of that?
Oh, definitely, yes.
Because just think the difference in where we were coming from. He's coming from Everett's, and I'm coming from another side of the world totally to meet in Nassau.
Top of the world, both
yes,
of you,
and
right?
Yes, and then to fall in love, and I have a song I call Ain't No Mountain High Enough, and I mean, what is this? Is this a strange thing?
You've been on the top of Mount Everest, and you have been Diana Ross. I mean, you have sold more records than anybody, practically. The two of you, where do you go from here? What kind of challenges do you now find?
That's easy. They can be little ones.
Yes.
Do you know where you're going to? Do you like the things life is showing you? Where are you going to? Do you know? Do you get what you're hoping for? When you look behind you, there's no open doors. What are you hoping for? Do you know?
Is this relationship, is that part of the answer?
What is the challenge in our relationship is, of course, that Diana is busy in her part of the world, and it takes us... We're not as much together as a normal married couple, and we don't live the life of a normal married couple either. We do look at our lives rather than a love affair, maybe, than a marriage, you know.
You started to take interest in her business world with you know, own one of the largest TV program distributing companies in the world, and you start mountain climbing, do you? Have you?
I don't think it's one of the largest video distribution.
And I don't
company.
Think I'm doing very much mountain climbing.
No, you don't. Johan is very, very interested in ecology.
That is the thing we must focus most on of all. I mean, if we don't straighten out our environment, nothing else matters. Nothing can be anywhere near as important. And I think hunger comes out of the environment. It doesn't. We look at it as a separate entity now, but I think it must be seen from the environment point of view.
I know that he hasn't mentioned it, but he's working on a very important project to maybe figure out a way that there is a prize, sort of like, or part of, maybe Nobel Peace Prize for ecology. And I know it's a big project he hasn't mentioned. It's a real important project that if we can get people to focal or put their attention on the nature, because all of the other things seem to come out of that. My attention is a lot as involvement with children, and it's a very important thing that if I can figure a way to do things for children. But I think when you have a lifestyle like ours, we travel a lot, life has been good to us. We're very blessed, and we, in a sense, want to, through our energies more than through our thoughts and through our energies and our dreams, is to make some changes in the world if we can. I have a new record out that's called What Can One Person Do? And I feel that one person can make a difference. If you have an idea and a dream, for instance, if someone say we're going to go to the moon, we might be able, we can do that, you know. So I just think you have to dream, and you have to set out to achieve your dreams. Important teeth now, those ones that hurt when they come in?
The canine, yeah.
The canine. Say hi. Say Arne.
No, you became parents when you were mature, right? Grown-ups.
I was still a child at heart, I don't know about you.
is there a difference now from when you were younger? I mean, do you have another attitude towards children?
I think we're really, what do you call it when you really want to see everything? You don't want to miss a moment of their growing up.
Yeah.
You realize how fast children grow up. I think if there's any difference at all, it's just your
life. I think somehow we are more conscious of having children. I think when I was 31, when I had my first child, I was too young. I mean, I wasn't conscious. I was, and it happened, at least for me, it happened simultaneous with the important part of my business career.
Now it's poetry.
Now it's poetry. For Diana, of course, her career never stops, so she's in the middle of it still.
Nana. Banana. Okay.
We have a little present for him, does he?
Nana.
That's for a little one, right?
Yeah.